So last time we discussed the definition of God according to chapter 13 of the Bhagavad Gita. God is supreme knower, he is the super knower, he is the real enjoyer, and he is the supreme controller. So we took these keywords from the purport. So what are we doing? We have these five senses: smell, taste, hearing, touch, and sight. With these, we are enjoying our five senses. That's what this little picture here on the left side is. So Lord is supreme knower and we are subordinate knower, right? So we don't know everything. We know what's happening in our body. So there is the field, which is our body. There is the supreme Lord also distributed in our body. And then we are the knower of the field, the finite enjoyer. We can enjoy only a little bit. We cannot enjoy a whole lot. And we have the capacity to enjoy sense gratification, means how to take care of the five senses, make them happy like that. So we can only know what's happening in our body and to a certain degree control it, but ultimately the Lord controls it. So super soul is the controller of both the field of activities and the finite enjoyer. So he's the infinite enjoyer. And we are the finite enjoyer. So super soul is the controller of both the field of activities as well as the finite enjoyer. So we have to think about cause and effect. Materials of which the body is made: earth, water, fire, air, ether. And under whose control is it working? Under the control of the Lord. How are the changes taking place? Our body is continuously making changes. Where from the changes are coming? What are the causes and what are the reasons? What is the ultimate goal of the individual soul? And what is the actual form of the individual soul? So these are the things that we need to contemplate on. We also talked about Brahman realization, Brahma Puccham, Jnanamaya, Pranamaya, Annamaya. Annamaya we start. This is last to last week. From Annamaya, we go to Pranamaya, realizing that there is Prana in every living entity. From Prana, we go to Jnanamaya, realization exists that beyond the living systems of thinking, feeling, and willing. From there, we go to Vijnanamaya. So Jnana, when it matures, it becomes Vijnana. So anything above the line is the Supreme Lord's territory. I mean, everything is under his territory, but this is primarily only he can do it. So we have to enjoy in dovetailing ourselves with the Anandamaya, Supreme Lord. Living entities normally consider themselves to be the enjoyer. But the enjoyer is really the Supreme Lord. So in the supreme stage, Anandamaya, realization of all blissful nature, pure bhakti stage. Then we talked about this field. So there are two fields, right? The one field is our body. Second field is the material nature itself. So what is there? There is intelligence. There are five great elements: intelligence, buddhi, false ego, ahankar, desire, icha, distress, you know, various kinds of problems. Then the unmanifested in the material, the energy. Then we have the five external senses and five internal senses, and then the mind. Then there is happiness, hatred, life symptoms, aggregate. And then the sense objects. Sense objects means something on which the sense runs after. Then we also talked about the supreme planet, Goloka Vrindavan, which is an octagonal shaped entity in which Radha Krishna are there. And then you have these petals of the Lord, of the lotus flower. There are 1008 petals in this lotus flower. We talked about the spiritual and material worlds. So then briefly, we also talked about Chatur Purusharthas, Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha. Maybe we didn't talk about it. We, you know, stopped there. So basically, our material life is involved with Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha. So we do righteous activities so that we can get some facilities. We enjoy those facilities, Kama, And then when we are disgusted with those facilities, we go after moksha. But modern life, there is no dharma, there is no moksha. They just do artha, they take money from the previous karmic facilities because they did some pious activities in the past. That is coming. So they just enjoy and give it up. And then this enjoyment fulfills certain, to a certain extent, desires. And again, you go after artha. So there is no dharma. That is the unfortunate part of the modern life. So our goal is the Panchama Purushartha, which is Prema Pumartha Mahan. Panchama Purushartha with singular. So love of God is our real goal. Krishna is craving for our love. We have to take shelter of Krishna as Arjuna is seeking to do during the Bhagavad Gita. And also, Brahman, God is everywhere. But how do you serve God who is everywhere? He dissolves his form into various atoms, every atom. That's in the Brahman stage of life. So it is very difficult to access. It's almost like if you are watching a train come from a distance, you cannot see the train that much. You see the smoke. You know that, yeah, there is something going on, but nothing more. When the train comes a little closer, that is like Paramatma. God is localized in our heart and in the every atom of the universe. But even how do you serve Paramatma? It takes lot of effort. First of all, it's very difficult to find Paramatma within the heart. Yes, he is there, but difficult to access. So it's very easy to relate with Bhagwan. It's just like now the train has stopped and the passengers have come down. It's very easy to relate to the passengers and talk to them and say, where did you come from? You cannot talk to the train or the bogies or anything like that. So Bhagwan access is like that. Very easy to access God in the Bhagwan form because he has a form, right? Here in Brahman, there is no form really. It is distributed across every atom in the universe. Paramatma, there is a form, but he's hiding in your heart. So again, somewhat difficult to access. First one is too difficult. Second one is somewhat difficult. Third one is very easy because God has a form. He is sitting on the altar and then you go and serve him. So again, to revise, there are four purusharthas, dharma. People do some kind of pious activity that results in artha, facilities, money, basic needs. Artha is also a good body. Some people are beautiful. Some people are ugly. The fact that you are beautiful means that you have some good karma from the past life. And then we fulfill our desires, inner desires, outer desires, whatever the case might be. And then when we are disgusted with fulfilling those desires, we'll say, okay, now let me try for moksha or liberation from the cycle of birth and death. But modern life, there is no dharma, no moksha, only artha and kama cycle. This keeps on going round and round and round. So any thoughts, any discussion on this? So then, we need to go into a little bit more detail about God. Neyam yattat pravakshyami. Yajnatvamritam ashnutem. Anadimat param brahma. I shall now explain the knowable, knowing which you will taste the eternal, Brahman, the spirit, beginningless and subordinate to me. lies beyond the cause and effect of the material world. Again, Lord revises chapter 2 here, right? The Vedic literature, Na Jayate Mriyate Vapi Upasech, is in the Katha Upanishad. And in chapter 2, he says, Na Jayate Mriyate Va Kadachin. Means the knower of the body, soul, never dies and is in full knowledge. So the body may die, it will disintegrate, but the knower of the body is never born. Means although temporarily it seems to be in the body, when the body goes away, again he is without a body. Actually, it is said that the soul never leaves the spiritual world. Means although we are having a body in the material world, it is like a dreamlike state. We never leave the spiritual world. The soul never leaves the spiritual world. But because we want to enjoy, this illusion is created in the material world for our enjoyment. So we think that, yes, I'm a man, I'm a woman, I'm going to office, I'm taking care of kids, I'm cooking. But technically, the soul is just dreaming all of this. The soul is there in the spiritual world. And it has never left the spiritual world. Why are we dreaming? Because we want to enjoy independent of Krishna. And that is called Maya. So we are in Maya. We think that we are doing so many things. But all of this is like a very long dream. It's like a very long dream. That is the definition of Maya. Means she'll make us think what is not existing is existing. So the Supreme Lord as Super Soul is also stated in Vedic literature to be Pradhana Kshetrajna Patir Guneshaha. Right? So this is a very important point. Pradhana Kshetrajna means he is the primary Kshetrajna. We are secondary Kshetrajnas. Remember what did we say last time? He is the knower of all fields and body. So that information comes from Svetasvara Upanishad. He is the Pradhana. Pradhana means primary or important. Kshetrajna means knower of the field of activities or Kshetras. Pradhana Kshetrajna Patir Guneshaha. So he is our Pati. Means Pati means he is our boss. He knows everything. And he controls everything. We try to, you know, just do a few things, but we don't have much freedom. Ultimately, show is gone by the Pradhana Kshetrajna. We are secondary, Dvitiya Kshetrajna. So that point we have to always remember. It appears that you are very free, but actually you are not very free. Everything is happening according to some boundaries. You are only playing, just like when kids want to play, you say, okay, go to backyard and play. Then you will ensure that the backyard door is locked. You know, kids cannot jump over the fence. So you ensure that all protection is there and then you let the kids play a little bit, right? You don't let the kids burn down your house. Play means very simple play. Maybe, you know, playing with some sand, or throwing a ball and somebody's hitting with a bat, or you are, you know, doing what, ring or tennis, or, you know, simple games. That's all you let the kids play, not dangerous games. Same way, the Lord allows us to play a little bit, but we don't have too much freedom. So in the Smriti, it is said, Dasha Dasa Bhuto Harer Eva Nanyai Saiva Kadachina. So Dasa Bhuto. Dasa means servant. We are servant of Harer, Hari. Hari means Krishna. The living entities are eternally in the service of the Supreme Lord. This is also confirmed by Lord Chaitanya in his teachings. Therefore, the description of Brahman mentioned in this verse is in relation to the individual soul. And when the word Brahman is applied to the living entity, it is understood that he is the Vijnana Brahma as opposed to Ananda Brahma. Again, two important technical points Prabhupada is giving us. Krishna didn't tell us this, but Prabhupada is looking at the scriptures and he is elaborating. What is the difference between God and us? So God is Vijnana Brahma. And we are, what are we?
Ananda Brahma.
Ananda Brahma, yeah. No, we are not Ananda Brahma. He is Ananda Brahma, we are Vijnana Brahma. You got the point? Remember, we have to go through that cycle.
Yes.
Vijnana and then Ananda. Anna means at a foodly platform. Prana, life platform. Jnana, knowledge platform. Vijnana, matured knowledge is called Vijnana. And then Ananda. So he is Ananda Brahma. We are Vijnana Brahmas, according to Prabhupada. Again, all of my knowledge comes from Prabhupada. I don't have any other basis to either conclude or question any piece of information. He has done all the research. We are just following him. Sarvataha pani padam tat.
Sarvataha pani padam taha.
Sarvato aksi siro mukham.
Sarvato aksi siro mukham.
Sarvataha sruti malloke.
Sarvataha sruti malloke.
Sarvam avritya tishtati.
Sarvam avritya tishtati.
Everywhere are his hands and legs, his eyes and faces, and he has ears everywhere. What does this remind you of?
His unlimited form.
Yes, his Virat Rupa or Vishwa Rupa, which we discussed in the previous chapters. Right? So, Lord is talking about himself and he's saying everywhere are his hands and legs, his eyes, heads, faces. He has ears everywhere. In this way, the super soul exists pervading everything. Right? Remember we said Paramatma is there in the heart of every living entity. Upadrishta Anumantacha Bharta Bhokta Maheshwaram. Paramatmeti Chapyukto Deharshi Barasarsava. So he is doing Upadrishta, overseeing, and Anumanta cha, means he is permitting us to do something. Even for you to raise your hand and slap somebody, you need to have sufficient karma so that you are able to do that. Otherwise, you cannot even slap somebody. Okay. Disham, please read this.
Yes, Prabhuji. As the sun exists diffusing its unlimited rays, so does the super soul or supreme personality of Godhead. He exists in his all-pervading form, and in him exist all the individual living entities. Beginning from the first great teacher, Brahma, down to the small ants, there are unlimited heads, legs, hands, and eyes, and unlimited living entities. All are existing in and on the super soul. Therefore, the super soul is all pervading. The individual soul, however, cannot say that he has his hands, legs, and eyes everywhere. That is not possible. If he thinks that under ignorance, he is not conscious that his hands and legs are diffused all over, but when he attains to proper knowledge, he will come to that stage. His thinking is contradictory. This means that the individual soul, having become conditioned by material nature, is not supreme. The supreme is different from the individual soul. The Supreme Lord can extend his hand without limit. The individual soul cannot. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that if anyone offers him a flower or a fruit or little water, he accepts it. If the Lord is a far distance away, how he can accept things? This is the omnipotence of the Lord. Even though he is situated in his own abode, far, far away from earth, he can extend his hand to accept what anyone offers. That is his potency. In the Brahma Samhita 5.37, it is stated, Goloka eva nivyasta akhil lam latma bhutaha. Although he is always engaged in pastimes in his transcendental planet, he is all-pervading. The individual soul cannot claim that he is all-pervading. Therefore, his verse describes the supreme soul, the personality of Godhead, not the individual soul.
Yeah. Anyway, we never thought that it applied to us because we don't have infinite number of hands, infinite number of legs, and reach everything, right? So there are a few things that Prabhupada says, Lord can extend his hand without limit. Right? Individual soul cannot. Lord is far distance away, but he can accept things. That's the second point. He is always engaged in pastimes in the transcendental planet. Although he is always engaged in his leelas in his transcendental planet of Goloka Vrindavan, he's all pervading. So right now, you know, you can be at one place, but not the other place. But he can be in both places all the time. Or three places all the time, four places all the time. So that's the point that is being made. So another point is super soul is all pervading. The individual soul cannot say my hands and legs are there everywhere. If your hand is, at the computer touching the mouse, then it's not doing something else because you don't have unlimited number of hands. You only have two hands. So when we sit for work, we're doing work. We cannot do gardening at the same time. But whereas super soul is all pervading because he knows how to distribute himself. And this kind of ties with this, right? We are knower of our field only, and we can only enjoy our field, our body. But he is knower of all fields and all bodies. That's the difference between God and us, Krishna and us. Sarvendriya Gunabhasham.
Sarvendriya Gunabhasham.
Sarvendriya Vivarjitam.
Sarvendriya Vivarjitam.
Asaktam Sarva Bhrikshaiva.
Asaktam Sarva Bhrikshaiva.
Nirgunam Gunabhoktarcha.
Nirgunam Gunabhoktarcha.
The super soul is the original soul of all senses. Yet he is without senses. He is unattached, although he is the maintainer of all living beings. He transcends the mode of nature, and at the same time is master of all modes of material nature. So seems contradictory, but it's not. He is the source of all senses. He is the Rishikesh. In Bengal, there was a minister when I was growing up. His name was Rishikesh Mukherjee. So Rishikesh means who is the master of all senses. And it says, yet he is without senses, means material senses, not spiritual senses. He still has spiritual senses by which he can do so many things. He is unattached, although he is maintainer. So you will do some puja, you'll ask for X. He's unattached, he'll give it to you. And later on, you cannot say, oh God, why did you give this to me? He says, you asked for it, I gave it to you. That's it. Unless, of course, you are a pure devotee, in which case, even if you ask for material things, he won't give. He will keep giving spiritual things. And it is said that he transcends the modes of nature, means he is not between these three modes of ignorance, passion, and goodness. So a lot of good points are mentioned in here. Okay, Gopal, read the purport.
The Supreme Lord, although the source of all the senses of living entities, does not have material senses like they have. Actually, the individual souls have spiritual senses, but in the conditioned life, they are covered with the material elements, and therefore the sense activities are exhibited through matter. The Supreme Lord's senses are not so covered. His senses are transcendental and are therefore called nirguna. Guna means the material modes, but his senses are without material covering. It should be understood that his senses are not exactly like ours. Although he is the source of all sensory activities, he has his transcendental senses, which are uncontaminated. This is very nicely explained in Shvetashvara Upanishad. In the verse, Apani Pado Ji Javano Grata, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Grita. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has no hands which are materially
contaminated,
but he has his hands and accepts whatever sacrifice is offered to him. That is the distinction between the conditioned soul and the super soul. He has no material eyes, but he has eyes. Otherwise, how could he see? He sees everything past, present, and future. He lives within the heart of living being. And he knows what we have done in the past, what we are doing now, and what is awaiting us in the future. This is also confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. He knows everything, but no one knows him. It is said that the Supreme Lord has no legs like us, but he can travel throughout the space because he has spiritual legs. In other words, the Lord is not impersonal. He has his eyes, legs, hands, and everything else. And because we are part and parcel of Supreme Lord, we also have these things. But his hands, legs, eyes, and senses are not contaminated by material nature.
So, Lord is not impersonal, means
he is a person.
He is a person, yes. Lord is a person. And he sees everything, past, present, and future. Say, suppose a devotee wants a promotion or some good business deal. Since the Lord knows the future, he won't give it to him if there is some danger in that. So the Lord will say, oh, if the devotee buys this land, he may get into trouble, 20 years down the road, So I will not even let him buy that land. So then you put in the earnest money deposit and you won't get the land. Then you start saying, God, what is this? I'm such a nice devotee and you are not giving me this. But Krishna is saying, you know, to himself, if I gave you this 20 years from now, you'll be in trouble. That's why I'm not giving it to you at all to begin with. Right? So he, since he knows the history as well as the future of a particular activity, he will not let devotees fall into big time troubles. To test devotees, he may give some small troubles, but if there's something really problemsome, he will actually not give that to you. Why? Because he lives within the heart of the living being and he knows what we have done in the past. He also knows what's awaiting us in the future. So due to forgetfulness, we forget what we have done. We think we are very good people. But he knows that we have done something so bad that we may be attacked by someone. That's why he will save us by changing our course direction and giving us some different thing, not the thing that we want. Okay, continue. Did you already read this? Looks like.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah. Okay, we are done. Yeah, you are right. Lord appears as he is by his internal potency. So that is called Antarangika Shakti. Outside Shakti is called Bahirangika Shakti. Inside is called Antarangika.
This one not finished yet, Prabhuji.
Okay, then read.
Bhagavad Gita also confirms that when the Lord appears as he is by his internal potency. He is not
We cannot hear him.
Bhagavad Gita also confirms. Is it okay, Prabhu?
Yeah, now it's okay.
Bhagavad Gita also confirms that when the Lord appears as he is by his internal potency. He is not contaminated by the material energy because he is the Lord of material energy. In the Vedic literature, we find that his whole embodiment is spiritual. He has his eternal form called Sachit Ananda Vigraha. He is full of opulence. He is the proprietor of all wealth and the owner of all energy. He is the most intelligent and full of knowledge. These are some of the symptoms of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is the maintainer of all living entities and the witness of all activity. As far as we can understand from Vedic literature, the Supreme Lord is always transcendental. Although we do not see his head, face, hands, or legs, he has them. And when we are elevated to the transcendental situation, we can see the Lord's form. Due to materially contaminated senses, we cannot see his form. Therefore, the impersonalists who are still materially affected cannot understand the personality of Godhead.
Yeah. So, some good points here. He's not contaminated by material energy because he's the Lord. Of that energy, says the boss. So how can, you know, your car come and dictate to you? You own the car. So it will listen to you. You will take the keys, you open it, you drive it. So when we are elevated to transcendental situation, we can see the Lord's form. Right now, you are seeing his Archa Vigraha in the temple. The one that is used for Archana or Puja. But when we are purified, we'll see his Swayam Rupa. We'll see his original form. Right now, you cannot see. It's not even advisable to think that we should see them because we are not qualified yet. So the impersonalists means people who don't believe in the personal form of the Lord cannot understand the personality of Godhead. We cannot understand, even though we are personless. But impersonalists are even farther away because they don't even think God as a person. So how can they see him? There's no question of seeing him. It's just speculation. Maybe God looks like this. Maybe God looks like that. So in this speculation, their whole life will go away. They'll just start dreaming. They'll just start thinking, oh, maybe God is like this. Maybe God is like that. And entire life goes away. So we don't want to be like that. Next one, Bahirantascha Bhutanam.
Bhutanam.
Acharam charam eva cham.
Acharam charam eva cham.
Sukshmatvat tad avigneyam.
Sukshmatvat tad avigneyam.
Durastam chantike chatat. The Supreme Truth exists outside and inside of all living beings. The moving and the non-moving. Because he is subtle, he means Krishna, he is beyond the power of material senses to see or to know. Although far, far away, he is also near to all. So this is the dilemma. He is subtle, so your material senses cannot see. But if your senses are purified and you're on that transcendental platform, you can see right in front of you that he's there. And this truth exists inside and outside. Outside as Brahman, inside as Paramatma. And in his own abode, far, far away in the spiritual world as Bhagavan. And he comes down once in a while as avatar. And we make his form and pray to him in the temple called Vigraha, right? Archa Vigraha. So in that form, we worship him. Okay, so who's the iPhone? Oh, iPhone dropped already. So maybe Girish, if you're there, you can read.
In the Vedic literature, we understand that Narayana, the Supreme Person, is residing both outside and inside of every living entity. He is present in both the spiritual and material worlds. Although he is far, far away, still he is near to us. There are the statements of Vedic literature. These are the statements of Vedic literature. Asino, Duram, Vyajati, Seno, Yati, Sarvata, in the Katha Upanishad. And because he is always engaged in transcendental bliss, we cannot understand how he is enjoying his full opulence. We cannot see or understand what these material senses, with these material senses. Therefore, in the Vedic language, it is said that to understand him, our material mind and senses cannot act. But one who has purified his mind and senses by practicing Krishna consciousness in devotional service can see him constantly. It is confirmed in Brahma Samhita that the devotee who has developed love for the Supreme God can see him always without cessation. And it is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita that he can be seen and understood but only by devotional service. Bhaktya Diva Anyana Sakya.
Yeah, thank you. So some more good points. We cannot see or understand with material senses. Period. We cannot. One who has purified senses by practicing Krishna consciousness can see him constantly. So all the vast majority cannot see. If we purify our senses, we can see him constantly. He can be seen and understood only by devotional service. Bhaktyatva ananya shakya. So only by devotional service, he can be seen. So if you become a devotee of Krishna and you do the required processes, then you can see Krishna. And so many people have seen Krishna. And Krishna could be right in front of you, but you are unable to see because of materially contaminated senses. Contaminated means what? They go after matter, right? So eyes want to look at something good or beautiful. Ears want to hear something which is pleasant, although the situation could be pretty unpleasant. Like that. Avibhaktam cha bhuteshu.
Avibhaktam cha bhuteshu.
Vibhaktam iva cha sthitam.
Vibhaktam iva cha sthitam.
Bhuta britar cha tadnyayam.
Bhuta britar cha agnayam.
Grasishnu prava vishnu cha.
Grasishnu prava vishnu cha.
It's an interesting word, grasishnu. Grasishnu means devouring, means something that finishes everything. Prava Vishnu is something that is developing. Although the Super Soul appears to be divided among all beings, he is never divided. Remember, I said he is doing this distributed processing. So one may think that he is already divided. The Supreme Lord is got divided. No, that's exactly what is being said here. No. Although he appears to be divided, he is never divided. He's situated as one. Although he's the maintainer of every living entity, is understood that he devours and develops all. Means he'll finish off some people, he will start, you know, giving more activities to other people. Continuously, this is going on. Okay, continue. Somebody read.
The Lord situated in everyone's heart as a super soul. Does this mean that he has become divided? No. Actually, he is one. The example is given of the sun. The sun at the meridian, it is situated in its place. But if one goes for 5,000 miles in all directions and asks, where is the sun? Everyone will say that it is shining on his head. In the Vedic literature, this example is given to show that although he is undivided, he is situated as if divided. Also, it is said in Vedic literature that one Vishnu is present everywhere by his omnipotence, just as the sun appears in many places to many persons. And the Supreme Lord, although the maintainer of every living entity, devours everything at the time of annihilation. This was confirmed in the 11th chapter where the Lord says that he had come to devour all the warriors assembled at the Kurukshetra. He also mentioned that in the form of time, he devours also. He is the annihilator, the killer of all. When there is a creation, he develops all from their virgin state. And at the time of annihilation, he devours them. The Vedic hymns confirm that the fact that he is the origin of all living entities and the rest of all. After creation, everything rests in his omnipotence. And after annihilation, everything again returns to rest in him. These are the confirmations of Vedic hymns. Yato va Imani Bhutani Jayante Yena Jatani Jivanti Yat Prayanti Abhisham Visanti Tad Brahma Tad Vijignasava. Maitreya Upanishad.
So, again, this is the continuation of the previous theme. Lord is there in everybody's super soul. Does he mean he has become divided? No. He's still one. Sun, right? Every country you go to, you see sun. And if you ask them, where is the sun? They'll say, above my head. Unless it is evening and sun is setting. How can the same sun be above everybody's head in across all planets? Because it's in a particular location, a particular angle, it appears that the sun is always in one place. So similarly, one Vishnu is present everywhere by his omnipotence, as sun appears in the many places to many persons. So example of sun is easy to comprehend. Whereas with Vishnu, it takes a little while for us to understand this. So although he is the maintainer of every living entity, he maintains us, right? By giving food, clothing, shelter, whatever. He devours everybody at the time of annihilation, means Mahapralaya. During Mahapralaya, everything will get destroyed. So in that sense, he is the annihilator or killer of all. Because he can basically finish everybody. After creation, everything rests on his omnipotence. After annihilation, everything again returns to rest in him. So, after creation, Lord's energy is sustaining us. We are going forward. And after annihilation, all of the souls will again go back to him. So, very interesting. Because after wrapping up, and there's so in Srimad Bhagavatam, there is also one more place where the analogy of the spider is given. So spider goes to a new room within your home. What it will do? It will start building a new cobweb for it to spread out. But then what happens if there is some kind of danger? Whatever web it laid out using its saliva, it pulls everything back inside. You should see this, very interesting spiders. Like you go and scare them, you know, take a broom and try to break its home. It'll immediately suck all the that spider thing, and then again it'll go away. So that is how the analogy is given. The Lord will create all these universes, but when necessary, he will just finish all these universes and suck them in. So, here this word is important, Viji Jignyasasva. So, Jignyasa, but this is Vijnana, means with the knowledge. Mature knowledge is called Vijnana. Knowledge is called Jnana. Just knowledge is of not much use. So somebody says, yeah, due to chemistry, this is what happened. Due to physics, this is what happened. Due to psychology, this is what happened. But then somebody has to put all these things together and finally come to the conclusion. Behind all these creations, there is some kind of creator running the show. Nothing is happening automatically. Okay, we'll stop there because today is the Christmas feast thing. So if you have energy, you can go and have the Christmas feast in the temple. Any questions? Okay, see you all next week then.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.